Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, the Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exhort, we edify, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about a successful spiritual personality. A successful spiritual personality. And who best can be put in that position? Who can model it for us other than my Lord Jesus Christ? So today we are going to be talking about my boss, my husband, my brother, he's my redeemer, so he's everything. So we're going to be talking about him, okay? So he's going to be teaching us how we can have a successful spiritual personality. But before we go into our lesson, let's pray. Father, we thank you. Lord, you are so good. You are the rock of our stronghold. You are so beautiful. Jesus, you are beautiful. And we just want to say we love you. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for your hand that upholds us every day. And Lord, we ask that through your word, you will bless us on this teaching program. And all the listeners will be blessed through this lesson. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, our foundation text is 1 John chapter 2, verse 6. The first epistle by Apostle John, chapter 2, verse 6. He who says he abides in him, that is, the individual who says he abides in Jesus, ought himself also to walk just as he, Jesus, walked. In other words, walk the walk, don't talk the talk. That's the simple English. All right? So, the objectives for this lesson, you know, once in a while we do objectives in this program. The objectives we are looking at is, number one, we are going to learn three spiritual personalities through this lesson. And through those three personalities, we are going to see how we can develop six godly characters. All right? Three personalities, six godly characters with which we can conquer the three enemies that we have, that daily tempt us, if you are a believer. And if you are not a believer, if you are still a pagan, you don't have the Holy Spirit in your heart, it can change. All right? That status can change. Just hang on, stay with me, okay? What is the image of a successful spiritual personality? And if you want to read about these personalities, feel free to go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 2 to 6. We are not reading that, but I love to challenge my viewers to be Bible students. So 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 2 to 6, go read it. When you read something for yourself in the Bible, nobody can take it away from you. No pastor can mumbo jumbo anything for you, all right? So please, feel free to read that. The first personality is a soldier. Obedience and loyalty are the two characteristics that put being a soldier in its own class. If you want to be a teacher, a journalist, an engineer, a plumber, a painter, you don't need to be loyal. To your employer. You can walk off anytime, you see. And you may decide to use your right and disobey them. You leave their job. But when you are a soldier, forget it. Obedience and loyalty is a must, you see. A soldier's obedience to go wherever they are sent, whenever they are sent, with whomever they are sent, and however they are sent, shows they have voluntarily relinquished, underscore that word, relinquished their personal freedom. The readiness to die for the cause of the country they serve showcases their loyalty to what they believe in and have taken up as their calling. It amazes me. I don't know where anybody who hates a soldier or a law enforcement, really, but it amazes me when these wonderful people, when they come back from Afghanistan, from Iraq, and all that, and they are asking them, and they say it's good to be back home, but if I have to go back, I won't think twice. I'm like, get out of here. You just came back. You see? It's because they believe in the cause they have taken on. That's a soldier for you. Christ has equally called us, believers, to be his soldiers. This requires total obedience and unhindered loyalty, regardless of the cost. A soldier will not tell you, oh, I'm not going to Afghanistan. Oh, no, I just got married. No, they don't care. They tell them, your position is in somewhere in a war-torn country in Asia or Africa. They are ready to go, you see. Obedience and loyalty to Christ are the pillars of our faith. Listen, when we are talking about faith in Jesus Christ, the two legs that faith stands on, which you walk, is obedience and loyalty. You are not obedient to Jesus Christ, and you say you have faith, you're kidding yourself. All right? Jesus displayed obedience to God even unto death, the death of the cross. Christ's loyalty to save mankind made him stoop to a level, so much so the Pharisees and the pagans of his time, they had problems believing his deity, you see. Christ has called us to submit ourselves to God in obedience and to resist the devil, to show our loyalty to Jesus Christ. You see, when you submit yourself to God, according to the book of James, that is obedience. And when you resist the devil, that is loyalty. You're not running away from the fight and say, oh, because the devil is attacking me, you see. Only a spiritual soldier of Jesus Christ can successfully overcome the temptations from the devil, you see. Let's go to the gospel according to St. John chapter 14, verse 15. John 14, 15. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Three words. Keep my commandments. That's it. Don't sing how you love Jesus. Show how you love Jesus. Let me say that again. Because we all love to sing that song. It's easy to sing. Anybody can sing. Hollywood is singing, all right? Don't sing how you love Jesus. Show how you love Jesus. Moving on. An athlete. So you are not only called to be a soldier, you are also called to be an athlete. Christ demonstrated discipline and commitment in his daily life. So to be an athlete, if you want to be successful, you have to be disciplined and be committed. He made a deliberate decision to not allow anyone or any situation to alter his personal times with God. Jesus would wake up very early in the morning to go pray. Sometimes late at night. I mean, they are looking for him. They don't know where he is. He's going to pray. He was focused on his agenda and he pursued it with undistracted attention. He rejected personal gain when the devil offered him the glory of this world. It takes discipline to reject Satan's carrots. Okay? He refused popularity when the Jews would have made him king. You see, if it were 21st century, he healed the lame, he healed the blind man, he raised the dead, before you know it, you will have seen Jesus Christ of Nazareth International Ministry. You see, because they will think, oh, now we are made, now we are popular. Not Jesus. He wasn't looking for popularity. There was discipline and commitment to why he came to die on the cross. He restrained his power when he could have destroyed those who came to arrest him. When my big brother, Simon Peter, when he chopped off the ear of Malchus, according to the book of Mark, Jesus said, put your sword back into its sheath. You think I don't have the power to command 12 legions of angels to come and fight? Huh? You see, he restrained his power when they came to arrest him. And he did not break any of the promises he made to his followers. I'm yet to see anybody to come up, agnostics, atheists, or whatever they call themselves, to say, oh, Jesus promised in one part of the Bible, he didn't fulfill it. Uh-uh. Not the Jesus of the Bible. This is a life to which we have been called by Jesus Christ to be disciplined in a Christian walk. You see, somebody said that the Christian walk is not cake in one hand and coffee in the other, which is true. It's a life of discipline. If you are truly a child of God, your life has to be disciplined because the Holy Spirit will discipline you. But if you are just everywhere and you call yourself a Christian, you need to go back again and check really with the Holy Spirit. To subdue the natural instincts that want to produce polluting works that seek self-glorification. I like the way Dr. Barnes put it. He says, desiring prestige, social leadership, or to want to dominate or impress others with their importance. End of quote. It takes discipline to subdue that natural instinct, to be seen, to show off, to glorify yourself. It takes discipline and commitment. And you can't do it on your own. The Holy Spirit himself will do it for you, you see. Recently, I had a situation whereby somebody, we were exchanging emails, it's an official business, and this lady at a point, she was kind of snappy and rude, and she put a title at the bottom of her name, maybe to let me know, and I honestly felt like, who do you think you're talking to, you see, and I wanted to respond and put some titles there myself, and the Holy Spirit said, Zion, what's going on? That is worldliness. And I'm like, that's right. So I'm like, Father, forgive me. So I shut that madness down. And I just humbly replied, just put my name there, Josephine Zion Taylor, you see, and sent it. And 2 days later, I flashed back and I said, thank you, Jesus, for helping me at that moment that worldliness was tempting. See, flesh was tempting me to give it to that lady. The same way, you see, if the Holy Spirit was not in the house, I would also want to prove who I was to her. But that's not who I am. The titles of my degrees are not who I am. Who I am in Jesus is what makes me who I am, you see. Praise God. So we need that discipline and commitment. To be committed in a resolve to be conformed, that is melted and molded like a cake. I don't know if you bake, but I do bake for my family. And if you put your liquid cake mixes in the pan, by the time it's baked, it will come out in the exact shape of that pan. That's what Jesus wants us to be. He wants to melt us with his fire of purity and pour us into his pan. And by the time he's passed us through the fire of testing of our faith, we come out like him, you see. So we can become the image of Jesus Christ. How can we do that? By becoming a Bible student and living a life of prayer, you see. Listen up. Only a spiritual athlete of Jesus Christ can successfully overcome the temptations from the world. If you are not disciplined in the power of the Holy Spirit, if you are not committed to the cause of Jesus Christ, seeking the glory of Jesus alone, seeking his glory and not your glory, you can make it as a spiritual personality. No, you can't. And it takes the Holy Spirit. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 to 17. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, we stop at 17. Do not love the world, that is, world's pattern of behavior, or the things in the world, that is, what the world has to offer you. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world, get this, is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. When the heart does not seek the Father, the heart becomes sick. Let me say that bread on the go again. A senior pastor gave me a few months back. I don't even think he remembers. When the heart doesn't seek the Father, the heart becomes sick. It takes discipline and commitment to seek the Father. Moving on. A farmer. So God has called us to be a soldier, an athlete, and now he's calling us to be a farmer for him. Hard work and patience are the hallmarks of a good farmer. Everywhere Jesus went, he went about preaching, planting the seeds of God's word. He took every opportunity, circumstance, or incident to teach and preach. Jesus preached from nature. He used trees to preach. He used the weather to preach, you see. He used everyday language and examples to simplify spiritual truth for his listeners. When I got to this part, I remember an individual. I mean, thank God, I don't get letters from that individual anymore. I mean, by the time I read two lines, I will be looking for a dictionary. With all these big terms and vocabularies, you see. That's why I like to go by basic English, you see. Because I want to be like Jesus. Jesus never spoke any mucky-muck Shakespearean English. No. Well, he spoke Aramaic, really. But he spoke in everyday language as a good teacher and the planter of the word, you see. And he used examples to simplify spiritual truth for his listeners. He asked his disciples questions to see their level of understanding of what he is teaching them. You see, a good teacher will always come back to the student. What did I say? What was the last thing I said? Because you want to test them to know if they are following you. Jesus modeled all that, you see. He's a good teacher, isn't he? So as a teacher of the word of God, Jesus was a spiritual farmer. And I took this language, I don't know, maybe sometimes early this year, late last year. When people ask me, because you tell some people you are a Bible teacher, whoo, they're gone. They will think you are, she will be super holy. So the people get you, they tend to feel intimidated. So when people ask me, I'm either a teacher or a farmer, you see. So they want to know more. I'm a farmer, I'm a spiritual farmer, you see. And this farming, Jesus has also called on his disciples to do. He has called us to go and preach to all nations. This is called the Great Commission. You are watching the Great Commission. And Jesus is expecting you to take the Great Commission to your workplace, to your friends, to your relatives, to your neighbors, you see. Doing so will make you a spiritual farmer too. Right now, I'm farming. I'm sowing the seed of the Word of God into your life. You are to be the same because it's not limited to me alone. Christ was patient. You see, when you're a farmer, you are not only hardworking, you also have to be patient. He patiently repeated himself to his listeners. This is where I always know those who have been called as teachers to be, who see teaching as their ministry or their calling if they're in the school system, and those who are just in the school system to teach to get paid, you see. A good teacher will never lose their patience because the students are asking questions to repeat, for the teacher to repeat him or herself. Oh no, it's the joy of any teacher to repeat themselves. But when you see a teacher that is like, why do you have to ask again? He's not a teacher, she's not. You see, so Jesus, he was happy to repeat himself. That's why you see the same story over and over again in some of the Gospels, you see. He answered every question his disciples and those who were honestly seeking, all the questions they asked him, he answered. Jesus was patient with the unrefined natures of his disciples, instead of throwing them away as defective products. Look at, what's his name? Simon Peter, impulsive, brutish, I mean, oh my goodness. Look at, what's his name now? Nathaniel, cynical. And John the Beloved, he was just clingy, always laying on Jesus' bosom. And Andrew and James, they were seeking prestige. Jesus, who is going to sit on your right and your left hand in heaven? Even a thief and a traitor like Judas Iscariot, Jesus was patient with him. You see, look at all these characters of people, and Jesus was patient with all of them. As Christ's farmers, it takes great patience for us to continue to pray for those whose hearts are hardened. I've listened to so many testimonies of mothers that pray for 20, 30 years for their babies, for their children to become Christians. And eventually, God answered. Some, they didn't live long enough to see their children saved, but after they are gone to be with the Lord, their children became saved, you see. They kept praying. That is the work of a good spiritual farmer. Just like Jesus was patient for his disciples and was praying for them, we ought to do the same. And we need to continue to preach to those who appear to be hardened or non-committal to the gospel. We should not be discouraged, you see. That is also patience. Only a spiritual farmer for Jesus Christ can successfully overcome the temptations from the flesh like anger, impatience, laziness, and so on, to bring others to Jesus Christ, thus bearing fruit for Christ. You see, let's go to the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 16, verse 15. Mark 16, 15. And he, Jesus, said to them, his followers, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." So don't say, "Oh, I talked to her once about Jesus and she snapped at me. Oh, she's the devil on two legs. I'm not going back to her again." Oh, no. Even if she or he has said, "Don't preach to me again," that's fine. Start praying. Start praying. Prayer evangelism, I call it. Start praying for that person. "Lord, I tried to preach to XYZ, but she said, don't preach to me again. He said, don't talk to me about this your Jesus again." And you have to respect that. But start praying for them. Eventually, God may crack them open, all right? Walk the walk to up his stock. Just a Messiah. You have to say that again because it's so beautiful. It's a beautiful rhyme, isn't it? Walk the walk to up his stock. All right? I call Jesus a businessman. He's into one business, the business of souls. That is stock. All right? So you walk the walk. That is how we bring increase to his stock. Amen. So what have we done so far? What is the image of a successful spiritual personality? A soldier. This is living a faith life of total obedience and complete loyalty to Christ and his cause, regardless of what we may suffer in the process. An athlete. This is living a disciplined Christian life that seeks Christ's glory rather than self-glory, and show commitment to be like Jesus through Bible study and prayer. A farmer. This is bringing unsaved people to Jesus by preaching to them at any opportunity and patiently waiting for their salvation as we pray for them. So let's conclude. As a genuine believer, which of these spiritual personalities do you lack or you need to improve upon? No one can boast of having it all. Forget it. It's not going to happen. None of us is going to have it all. No, we keep improving. I didn't have to go so far when the Holy Spirit was putting this lesson together, before I started to see my deficiency. Oh no, I didn't have to go far. So which one is yours too? With the power of the Holy Spirit, by his empowerment, through a disciplined life of prayer and daily Bible study. Have you studied your Bible today? Huh? Have you prayed? Through disciplined life of daily Bible study and prayer and obedience to divine instructions, we will continue to become more like Jesus. We are not going to be perfectly like Jesus on this side, oh no. But we can be improving, getting close every day. We ought to, amen. Make the necessary changes in your timetable. I am. That will help your spiritual growth. Okay? I just made one that God helped me with yesterday to help me with my spiritual growth. So look at your timetable. Whatever is taking time, your time from spiritual activities, cut it out. Your spiritual life is more important. Okay? Now, are you an unbeliever? Listen, I hate to tell you, but in this ministry, we don't sugarcoat. people know us. God cannot relate to you as his child until you are saved. Until you surrender your heart, you remain an outcast to Jesus. Sorry. However, you can change that horrible, horrible status right now. You don't have to wait till the next 2 minutes. No, right now you can cease from being an outcast to Jesus to being adopted by Jesus. Oh yeah, he wants to adopt you. If you are ready to be adopted, see, I was adopted too by Jesus. And so many believers who are watching me, they were adopted too. And we became brothers and sisters. So you can join us. It's a big family, all right? If you want to do that, a link is coming up. I am going to say a very short prayer so you can go to that link, okay? God bless you as you do that. Father, we thank you. Lord, I pray for those who are going to want to know Jesus page. Lord, open their hearts. Let them see your love. Let them understand your love that cannot be matched by any other love. And for us whom you have already adopted, Father, we pray that by your Spirit, you will help us to continue to make you proud. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be profitable for you and for the cause of the cross of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father God, for in Jesus' name I'll be praying. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.